give me some time to think. I'm in the bathroom looking at me. Facing the mirror is all I need. Wait until the reaper takes my life. Never gonna get me out alive. I will live a thousand million lives.
My patience is waning. Is this entertaining? My patience is waning. Is this entertaining?
All right, hello everybody. We're finally back. I think I took a month long hiatus from listening to Lauren read this book. We're on to chapter 8, everyone's favorite chapter. Jesus, YouTube changed its like format shit. So I gotta get used to it here. All right, let's say hello to everybody and then get cracking on this because I think it's a long chapter and I don't want to have to split up into two parts. Michael Amend, good to see you. Lila Daisy, Fantastic Planet. Oh, Jesus. Oh, my God. Anyway, All Killer, No Filler. Good to see you, All Killer, No Filler. 87, So-Called Cocksuckers. Paul's Life. Doom, do your homework. This will be here when you're done. Jesus. Dragon Warrior, Brandon, Polynomial Purbred, Miso Lorny, Pussy Destroyer, good to see you, Pussy Destroyer. We got Flaps and Clits. Clay is here. Jinx, of course, Octopushy, Allison Marie Armstrong. Good to hear those poop noises. All right. Let's dive on in to chapter 8. I feel like I should do a recap of what we've missed, but, you know, honestly, no. That's not,
Chapter 8.
Chapter 8.
The wedding day came, and Brooke and Aaron both had gotten sick before the ceremony. Aaron got sick because of his nerves, and Brooke got sick because of morning sickness from her being pregnant. Aaron lost his train of thought and his strength in his knees when Brooke entered the aisle, and he fell to the floor. He quickly regained himself and stood back up with embarrassment all over his face. He was completely stunned by Brooke's beauty in her wedding dress.
Well, okay, so this is like a big event in the book, right? It's the wedding. It's finally here. We didn't know that it was coming, but it's finally here. The wedding just it's happening. It started and it's happening, and all the stuff is done and all the stuff is planned for, and we haven't built up to it at all. And now we're in the middle of the wedding, and Brooke is walking down the aisle, and Aaron's stunned. What an awful buildup. This is fucking terrible. So much of this book, it's like, you know, he includes, but there's no point to it. There's no story relevance, but also, like, there's no buildup to it. It's supposed to be these pillars of the book, you know? But who gives a shit? There's the wedding. What happens at the wedding? Nothing. Nothing of note happens. It's not even built up too well. It's not even described well. I don't know if he talks about where they have the wedding, but it's just fucking awful.
His palms grew sweaty and his breaths got heavy as Brooke slowly approached him. Derek, being Aaron's best man, had to quietly whisper some of Aaron's lines to him because he was so nervous he kept forgetting them.
What did he say? Tell us what he said. What do you mean he kept his best man? He has one best man? Where's the other best men? Where's the other groomsmen? You know? Why? What were his vows? What does he know about Brooke? I love how even in Lauren's fantasy, he doesn't know anything about this person he's in love with. I was going to make that joke too,
Blake,
87 so-called cocksuckers.
Probably being his ring bearer, had lifted the small pillow up to Aaron and Brooke so they could slide the rings onto each other's fingers. I now pronounce you husband and wife. You may kiss the bride. Preacher finished. Aaron lifted Brooke's veil and placed a short but romantic kiss upon Brooke's lips. They both smiled with love in their eyes as they began to turn and walk out of the church. At the reception, Amy caught the bouquet and hugged Brooke before her and Aaron left for their honeymoon. They didn't really have much of a honeymoon because they were saving all the money they could for when the baby arrived.
It's already over. What an incredible wedding chapter this is. This is like a whole chapter in another book. And it's so obvious, right? At the wedding, Aaron should have an episode, but he keeps it private, and maybe his wife is suspicious that he was cheating on her on their wedding night, and there's a big problem or something. Something happens here, right? It's like so fucking obvious. But no, Brooke throws the bouquet and someone catches it and they leave immediately. And I don't know, what did they have to eat? Who was there? Where did they dance some? What was their first dance to? What song? I don't know. It's like it writes itself and he can't write anything down. It's like bullet points.
Settled for a weekend away from home in a nice hotel to serve as their honeymoon, with discussion of maybe in the future they would be able to have a real honeymoon. But for now, they were happy sacrificing for the future bills with the baby. Time went on after the wedding, and Brooke was already in her eighth month of pregnancy.
Jesus fucking Christ! What is happening? Time went on after the wedding, and now boom! Boom! She's 8 months pregnant. She's almost ready to give birth. When we started this chapter, the wedding hadn't even started. He's been reading, what is this, like 3 pages minimum? And there's been a wedding, a whole fucking wedding. They've gone on a honeymoon that weren't really a honeymoon. And now Brooke is 8 months pregnant. This is like 3 distinct chapters in a better book. Or in a decent book.
Believe how
book,
fast time has gone
which
by.
I guess it would be a better book.
It seems like it was just yesterday that we got married. Brooke told Aaron that she lay in bed with her.
Seems like it was just yesterday we got married. It was. In book time, from the audience's perspective, it was. It was, like, literally the last paragraph. Jesus Christ.
Like it was just yesterday that we got married. Brooke told Aaron as she lay in bed with her arms wrapped around him. Yep. Are you ready to be a mommy in about 2 more weeks? Aaron asked her. Yes, I am. Are you ready to be a daddy? She returned. Yes, I am, he answered with sincerity. We still have to think about what we're going to give our baby for a name, Brooke stated Maybe we should have the doctor tell us what sex the baby is so we can choose the name if we want for it. I thought we agreed that we wanted it to be a surprise, Aaron asked. We did, Brooke said with anger.
What amazing dialogue. You know, are you ready to be a mom? Yes, I am. Are you ready to be a dad? Yes, I am. Should we name the baby? So fucking stupid. Yes, Serenity, his storytelling skills are hilarious. And I like how this is one of his hobbies. He likes writing books. Of course, this is the only book that he's ever, like, seen through. So, you know, wrong. He doesn't like writing books. But this is, like, when he lists things as his hobbies, one of them is writing books. Like, dude, no. This is fucking terrible. And he thought that, like, he still thinks, I think it was with Casey, he was talking about how he wrote a book, but he didn't really market it. Like, as if he could market this pile of trash and it would sell well.
Anxiousness in her voice.
Anxiousness.
But I just thought it would be nice to have a name ready to give it when it arrives.
Yeah, having a name for your baby, you know, not a bad idea. Not a bad idea.
Well, why don't we choose a name for it?
Jeez.
If it's a boy, and a name for it if it's a girl.
Oh, Aaron, wow, what a great idea.
That's a good idea, Brooke agreed.
I agree. Me and Brooke are on the same page. Maybe I should be the one fucking Brooke, eh, Aaron?
We would have thought about that sooner.
Then again, she is a slight chunky, so maybe not.
I sat up for 3 hours that night thinking up names of people in the family with names they liked and other names they thought of on their own. Brooke had told Aaron to keep Sunday open and not make any plans so they could go through the baby name book she had gotten and decided on name.
You gotta spend a whole fucking day going through a baby? I don't know. I don't have a baby. But I if my wife or girlfriend or partner or whatever was pregnant and she was like, hey, set aside all day Saturday. We're gonna go through this baby book and pick a baby name. I'd be like, no. No, we're not. We're not gonna spend all fucking Saturday reading a book that has names and what they mean. Like, no, we're not gonna do that. Maybe that's just me. Maybe that's something that people do. They spend a whole day just sitting out. I would think you'd kind of just let it come to you, right? You'd be like, hey, what do you think of this name? And your partner's like, maybe. And, you know, you kind of toss that one around. And then a couple of weeks later, you come up with an idea. And you're like, what about this name? And they're like, no, I fucking hate that name. And you're like, okay, that one's out. They're just going to sit down and do it. I wonder if we're going to get a scene of them just reading names. That would be a good way to pad the book. I forget.
They decide
Does that
on
happen?
Names they would use for the baby. Sunday came around, and Brooke and Aaron spent the day on the couch and at the kitchen table going through the baby name book. Around 5 p.m., when Brooke was standing at the stove stirring the macaroni in the boiling water,
okay.
She felt something wet running down her leg.
Oh, no.
She looked down to find her pants soaked with water. Oh, no, she thought to herself.
She spilled macaroni and cheese.
Yeah. He answered.
Why is she muttering? Woman in the chats, if you've given birth, were you like, when your water broke, were you like, Aaron, did you say your husband's name under your breath? Did you mutter? Or were you like, oh my God, I'm about to have a baby! Get the keys, get my to-go bag. We're having a baby!
Did Edgy walk toward her?
So boring. Every fucking scene. This should be exciting. Oh my God, it's a baby. How about this? I don't know. Right, I don't know. I'm not a genius. How about this? They're at somewhere that's inconvenient to have a baby. And then they have to deliver it there for a contrived reason. How about that? I don't know. Why not do that? Yeah, Smokey the Cat, she's already giving birth. She's pregnant for 8 sentences. Right. Her pregnancy would be a great time for Aaron to have some episodes and shit. Like, she needs him there. She needs someone to help take care of her while she's pregnant. And maybe Aaron disappears a little bit. Maybe she's like, hey, you know, we just fucking got married. This shit needs to stop. You need to be home when you say you're going to be home. This is fertile ground, no pun intended, for some hijinks, for some taken abroad hijinks. And she's pregnant, and we got married, and she's going to have a baby.
Looked down and saw her pants soaked. What happened? He asked. My water broke, she
What the
replied.
fuck do you
Oh
think, you
shit,
idiot?
he muttered it as he began to groan.
Oh shit. Why is he swearing? Why is this the first time he swore? How come he never swore in the army? You kidding me? They're fucking firing at you. They're shooting at you, terrorists. And he's like, well, gee willikers. They sure are shooting at us, Paul. And Paul muttered, oh yeah, yeah. Well, they got guns, so that's why they're shooting at us.
He asked,
Fine. There you
my
go.
Water broke, she replied. Oh shit, he muttered it
oh,
as
shit.
He began to grow nervous and excited
he
at the
muttered?
Same time.
Why didn't he yell it? Oh
Brooke
shit!
Reached over and turned the burners to the stove in the off position. Grab my purse, she ordered.
Okay, good.
Aaron grabbed her purse
Persh.
And the car keys, then quickly came to Brooke.
Did everybody get that? Off position. The stove is in the off position. You know what? If I didn't know how fucking stupid he was, I would assume that that's like a red herring. Like, he thought he turned the stove into the off position, and then they're going to go and have the baby. But when they then, you know, oh, we're happy that we had a baby, but Aaron gets a call. He has 15 missed calls on his cell phone after the baby's born. And he checks, and his mom was calling him 15 times. Aaron, your house burned down because you left the stove in the on position. So fucking stupid. He's so fucking stupid.
Brooke decided to help her to the car. He carefully helped her in. He carefully helped her in, then climbed in himself and fled to the hospital as fast and as safe as he possibly could.
Fled?
He called
the
hospital
hospital
on the way so they would be ready and waiting at the emergency entrance. Okay. Once they arrived, they put Brooke in a wheelchair and rolled her through the delivery room. Aaron's nerves were shot when his mother showed up 12 hours later. Why is it taking so long for the baby to come out? He asked his mother quietly as he stepped away from Brooke's side for a
Ask
moment.
Ask the doctor, you fucking idiot.
That's natural,
idiot.
She answered him. I was in labor with you for 23 hours.
Yeah, dude, the macaroni and cheese is ruined. Now Aaron's head is going to be all fucked up. Yeah, you're right. That's a good point. Aaron's proud. This, you know what? You know, weirdly enough, the first 7 chapters have nothing to do with Aaron going crazy and murdering people. It's only now, after he doesn't get his hors d'oeuvres, that he's gonna snap. That's actually kind of true in the story. Like, he doesn't get the macaroni and cheese, and now he's gonna start murdering people. That's fucking crazy.
When the contractions get closer together, the baby will come out. I talked to the doctor, and he assured me that everything was fine with Brooke and the baby, so you don't have anything to worry about, Daddy.
Yeah.
His mom said assuringly. Thank you, Grammy.
Dude, I would shut that shit down so fast. I guess it's like personal taste, but you know, if I had a kid and my mom was like, "Okay, Daddy," I'd be like, "No, no, no, wait, hey, whoa, no, 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 you're not fucking calling me that." I would shut that down so fucking fast it would make your head spin. We're not doing that. I don't know what made you, I don't know what about my personality made you think that that's going to be how this is going to go, but it is not.
Aaron returned with a nervous smile. Six more hours went by, and the baby finally decided to come out into the world. The doctor didn't have to tell Aaron and Brooke what sex their baby was. They could see for themselves when the doctor cut the umbilical cord.
Right, the doctor was like, I'd tell you that you have a boy, but look at this schlong. Was the baby like 94% penis? What percentage of the body weight of this newly born child was penis? I love how he includes that. You know, the doctor didn't need to tell Aaron that his baby was a boy, because he had a huge penis. And it weren't even curved.
It was a boy. Aaron felt very proud.
Okay.
He would have felt just as proud if it had been a girl, but he was now a daddy, and that made him proud.
Okay.
We still don't have a name picked out for him yet, Brooke said with a heavy sigh and a yawn. You can pick out a name for him later.
Like, the doctor gives a shit. Like, the doctor's like, oh, really, you don't? Okay, I'll put him back in. Like, why say that to the doctor? Hey, thanks, David Kendrick. Lauren deserves everything he's gotten, but he has not gotten everything he deserves. Agreed, yeah. A lifetime of ridicule. Not enough. Not enough is what I say. A little bit more. Maybe in his next lifetime, when he's reincarnated as like a... I don't know, what's the worst thing to be reincarnated as? I'd like for him to be reincarnated as like a turtle and then get his head stuck in one of those can thing, the things that like combine all the cans. And he's just got to deal with that for like 180 years. That'd be
Sir
great.
interrupted. Right now, we're taking the baby to get him cleaned up and blood taken for tests and all.
Okay.
I want you, he pointed to Brooke, to get some much needed rest.
I want you to get some much needed rest. I'm surprised, you know, honestly, I'm surprised that the doctor didn't point at Aaron and say, I want you to get some much needed rest. This bitch can stay up with the kids. You seem like a great person, Aaron. I'm actually genuinely surprised that the doctor didn't point at Aaron.
What are the tests for? Aaron asked worriedly. Nothing to be concerned about, the doctor assured him. It's all routine so that we can find out the baby's blood type and all
Does
that
he
good
not,
information.
does Aaron not know anything about, you know, a child being born? Like, I would read a book. You know, they have to make sure that the kid's safe. They're gonna watch it so that the mom can get some sleep for the first couple of days. I don't know. I don't know. Why is he such a fucking idiot? You know what this kind a lot of his scenes kind of read like remember when he was talking to the recruiter and he was asking like the most basic questions? They kind of read like a children's TV show, like The Backyardigans. There'd be an episode where Pablo, no pun intended, Pablo joins the army and he asks all the basic questions to teach little kids about like, you know, what the army is or whatever. These scenes, it's like, is this for children? Is this like a basic questions that children would ask when a child is born? So fucking stupid. Yeah, Cat G, the worst thing to be reincarnated as is Lauren Armstrong. You know, actually, yeah, I'll change that. I would want Lauren to be reincarnated in the next universe. That's just a perfectly cyclical universe where he's himself again.
Oh, okay. Aaron sighed and relaxed.
Okay.
The nurse took the baby from Brooke's arms and followed the doctor out of the room. Brooke hated to release her newborn baby, and her eyes began to tear as she did so. She was
Oh.
very tired and really needed the rest that the doctor had ordered.
Well, Aaron needs the rest more.
You can go home and get some sleep if you want to, Mom, Aaron said as he noticed his mother's eyes begin to close while sitting in
No,
the only
she
chair in the
can't.
room. No, I want you to go lay down on the couch in the waiting room and get some sleep. The administrative lady said that it's always slow this time of night, so you won't bother anyone in the waiting
Who
room.
cares?
I'll stay here with Brooke
Is he okay? You know, I fucking hate. I hate how much he keeps setting things up and then not paying anything off. Like, okay, Lauren, Aaron is gonna go into the waiting room away from Brooke, and she's gonna be asleep for a while, and his mom is gonna watch over her. So Aaron's free to do stuff. Maybe he does something. But no, he's just gonna go and sleep. Hey, thanks, David Kendrick. Fleas pray at night not to be reincarnated as Lauren Armstrong. It's a fate worse than death. I'd rather not exist than be Lauren. Fleas have the self-awareness to be ashamed of potentially being Lauren, but he doesn't have the self-awareness to be ashamed of being
But she's
himself.
sleeping, his mother replied. All right, I'll come back as soon as I wake up. I love you. Aaron told Brooke as he kissed her and left the room. Now, you close your eyes and get some sleep, Aaron's mother told Brooke with a pat on her hand. I'm going to sit in this chair and knit my new grandson, an outfit, and I'll be right here when you wake up. Thank you, Brooke said with a tired smile, then closed her eyes and went to sleep. Around 6 a.m., Aaron woke up and looked around him. It took him a moment to realize where he was and why. He sat up and rubbed his eyes into focus, then made his way back in.
Oh, okay. Who cares? Who fucking cares? He woke up the next morning and went to go visit Brooke. Does he go and visit his kid? Nothing happens. Who fucking cares? The point of these meandering chapters in like murder mystery novels, like he doesn't understand this, but the point of these chapters in murder mystery novels is to distract you from what's actually going on. It's to hide little clues in the mundane shit. So that you, upon rereading it or looking back, oh, that's when something happened. Just nothing is happening. It's like a journal. It's just the day-to-day goings-on of the most boring man who's ever been to Iraq or Afghanistan or wherever the fuck he was stationed.
He walked in and found his mother putting the finishing touches on her grandson's new outfit that she worked on tirelessly through the night. He looked up to see that Brooke was still sleeping.
Okay.
Did you sleep well? His mother asked in a whisper. Yes, I did. Did you get any sleep? He asked with a concern. Nope, she said with a grin. I was too busy working on my new grandson's outfits to sleep.
I was up on me.
Why don't you go to the cafeteria and get us a bite to eat and some coffee, his mother suggested. All right, I'll be back in a few minutes, he replied.
Oh, God.
All the way to the cafeteria and back, Aaron began thinking up names for her son.
Yeah, Paula's laugh. Brooke has, none of her family came. That's like an ongoing theme. I think that's like a subconscious thing for Lorne, where like his ideal woman would have no support system, so he could just, you know, do whatever the fuck he wants and abuse her as much as he wants. But yeah, none of her friends came to visit. None of her friends, oh my God, Brooke, you're a mom. Like, none of her friends construct a family unit for her, take on that role because they know that her family isn't around. It's just Aaron. This is a very depressing story about this woman. What's she gonna do when Aaron dies? I mean, Aaron's mom is old as shit. So when she dies, and Aaron, of course, dies at the end of the story, spoiler alert, what's Brooke gonna do? She's gonna be all alone with Trevor, a murderer's son.
He almost spilled the two coffees twice on the way back.
And Brooke doesn't work. So what's gonna happen with Aaron after Aaron's gone?
His mind drifting off, thinking about his son. He returned to the room to find Brooke, now awake, looking in awe at the outfit that Aaron's mother had knitted that night. It was blue. It was blue with white trim on the sleeves and along.
Who cares?
And along the line of buttons.
What does Aaron look
so
like?
So adorable, she said it as she thanked her mother-in-law. Hi, honey, she said to Aaron. Hi, Aaron replied after he handed the coffee and vanished to his mother and set his on the small table in the corner of the room. How are you feeling? He asked as he bent over and kissed her lips. I'm feeling much better now that I've gotten some rest, she replied.
Gav, yes. Taken Abroad is how Lorne wishes his life was. Minus the murder. The bulk of the story, mundane shit. I think in one of the previous chapters, he had breakfast 4 times in one chapter. Like, it's just so boring. Everybody just loves Aaron. And, you know, work, you know, I don't think he's mentioned him having a job at any point. So that's not important. It's just so fucking stupid. It's literally 3 characters in this entire story. There's Aaron, there's Brooke, and there's Aaron's mom. That's the entire fucking cast. And that's what Lorne wishes his life was. Him, his girlfriend, his wife, who didn't ever talk to anyone else ever, and his mom. And the only thing that's inaccurate is they have a boy child. He would love a girl child, and then he could rape her when she was 13.
I've been thinking about the baby's name, Aaron said. Do you like the name Trevor? He asked her. Yes,
no,
I do. How about
hate
Trevor
it.
Michaels? She asked him in return.
Oh, it's perfect.
Aaron thought for a moment, then said the name out loud so he could hear it.
Trevor Michael.
He said a second time. I like it. He answered and kissed her.
George Michael. I like it.
I guess we have a name for him now, Brooke said as she took Aaron's hand in hers. That's good, a voice said from the doorway, because you have to fill out the baby's birth certificate. A nurse walked in behind the doctor with the baby in her arms and bent over to gently place the baby in Brooke's arms. Aaron looked at Brooke, the baby, and his mother proudly.
Okay.
When will we be able to take the baby home, Aaron asked. Tomorrow. All you need to do today is all the paperwork.
Oh my God. Are they, legitimately, are they going to do the paperwork? I bet them doing the paperwork takes more sentences than the wedding and her pregnancy.
The hard part is all over now, the doctor replied.
Hey,
thank you, doctor.
Hey.
Aaron said as he shook the doctor's hand. Save my cigar, the doctor said jokingly. I'll smoke it when my shift is over.
What?
They all smiled at the doctor's remark. Watch him walk out and
Oh, you. Oh, that doctor, whatever his name is, that classic character, always making those quips and joking around. Oh boy. Whoa, what a wild character. I'm richer for the experience having known the doctor.
Watch them walk out of the room, then turn their attention back to the baby. They all enjoyed having the baby with them for 2 hours before the nurse came back in to take the baby back to the nursery. Aaron's mother finally decided to go home.
You know, here's an opportunity. Maybe Aaron doesn't feel a connection to the baby right away. You know, that happens sometimes. You know, people don't feel an innate connection with their children, and kind of, you know, the bond grows over time or something. That would be interesting. I mean, that would be something, right? That'd be something to happen in this book. Aaron held the baby, but weren't feeling like it were his baby. But
Call me
no.
get
They
the
just all
baby.
love the baby.
I'll come over to your house tomorrow. Just call me when you get home, and I'll help you two take care of the baby for a couple of days so that you can get used to the newcomer.
Yeah, that's a good point, Joey. The doctor isn't supposed to be male. That's bullshit. That fucking doctor saw your vagina and helped to bring my baby into the world? Jesus! God damn it, Brooke! Do you think Erin yelled at Brooke a bunch for letting a man see her vagina while the baby was being born? I bet he did. That's just omitted from the story.
She said before she left.
CPS had to get involved immediately after the child is born.
Aaron sat down beside his wife's bed and shared his Danish and coffee with her. The doctor came in when they finished the Danish with the paperwork for the baby's
Danishish.
birth certificate and insurance
Okay.
and a dozen other forms that they needed to fill out for the hospital.
Great. Who
It took
fucking
him until 3
cares?
p.m. to finish filling them out. The nurse made the bed next to Brooke so that Aaron could sleep in the same room with Brooke that night instead of in the waiting room on the couch. When morning arrived, Aaron went to the cafeteria to get the Danish and coffee for him and Brooke.
Oh
He
my
stopped by the
God.
nursery on the
Oh my
way.
God. Literally, we've had two breakfasts in like the past page. Okay, we get it. They're eating Danishes in the morning and they're filling out paperwork. Oh my God. Can something fucking happen? Who cares? Who fucking cares about anything that has happened in this whole goddamn chapter? Who cares? Did he really write this and think like, "Oh, this is really going to engage an audience?" No, of course not. It's just him sitting down daydreaming. And then he never read it again. He's reading it again now. I would really like for him to go, "Oh my God, this is fucking terrible." Like, Jesus Christ, this just goes on and on and on. Nothing happens. Jamie, I'm gonna have to edit this. This book sucks. This is awful. There's just no awareness. I think as he's reading this, he's like, "This is actually pretty good. I forgot how good my book were. I forgot that I had a Danish in my book twice."
Way back to peek in. He smiled at the nurse that was inside changing the baby's diapers and went on his way back to Brooke.
Maybe a pedophile shouldn't be describing changing a baby's diapers. I don't know.
Aaron walked back in the room to find the nurse taking Brooke's blood pressure and her heartbeat.
Thanks,
How does everything
Rosegold.
look? Aaron asked the nurse, who turned around quickly,
It looks
surprised with a
fine.
winning
Take the
voice.
baby home. Get the fuck out of my hospital.
She's good to go home with the baby today, she
Sir, you can't smoke in here.
told him. Good. I was hoping someone would tell me that, Aaron replied. What time can I take them home? As soon as the doctor comes in and gives you the okay to do so. He should be in here soon. Congratulations to you both, the nurse said before turning to leave the room.
The
About 10 minutes
room.
later, the doctor came in the room to have Aaron and Brooke sign some papers.
Oh my God!
As soon as Brooke
More
was.
fucking papers! Just sign the goddamn pa- No one cares. Leave the hospital. Get out of the hospital. No one cares. Oh, did they have to sign more papers? Like, hey, you know what? A good rule of thumb if you're writing a story is like, if someone was telling me this story, what would they want to know next? No one reading this was thinking, did they sign more papers? Did they have another Danish? No one fucking cares.
Dress, he could wheel her to the lobby where the nurse would meet them with her baby.
Okay.
Aaron helped Brooke off the bed and grabbed her clothes for her from across the room after the doctor left.
Okay, come
When
on.
she was dressed, he helped her ease into the wheelchair and wheeled her to the front desk where the nurse was waiting for them with the baby. Brooke held the baby close to her as Aaron wheeled her out front and
You
moved.
know what? Every part of this story is like an old person telling you a story. Right, you go and visit your grandparents, and your grandpa's like, back when I was your age, we had to getting on the train wasn't as easy as it is today. We had to do this and that and the other thing, and then, well, actually, this guy used to stand out front of the train station, and he had a whirly dirly, and he'd spin it around. You'd be like, Grandpa, just get to the fucking story. I don't care. Okay, great. Was he eating a Danish, Grandpa? I don't care. Get to the point of the story. Oh my God, it's so fucking frustrating. The worst part is I don't even care what happens next. It's just really. I can't believe he's a person. I can't believe that someone would write this.
Moved them both from the wheelchair to the car. On the way home, Eric called his mother.
Yeah, great question, NWA skeptic.
Hi, Mom. Brooke and I should be home in about 10 minutes, he informed her.
So you need to be there
Okay, I'll be there in
immediately.
about 1 hour unless you want me to wait a little longer, she replied. No, 1 hour will be great. Brooke and I both will feel a lot better with you there for a couple of days to help us out, he said. Okay, I'll see you in 1 hour then. Aaron hung up the phone, feeling relieved that his mother would be there to help him with the baby. They both were a little nervous about becoming parents and didn't want anything to happen to the baby because of lack of knowledge. Aaron helped Brooke into the house with the baby in her arms. After getting them settled and comfortable on the couch, he returned to the car to retrieve the rest of the things they received from the hospital, along with a new baby outfit that his mother knitted. When he returned to the house with his arms full, the baby was already crying. He set all the items on the table and rushed to Brooke's side. Is he all right? He asked worriedly. Yes, she answered. He's just hungry. Can you hand me his bottle? It's on the counter. Aaron fetched the bottle and handed it to Brooke. As soon as the nipple was in the baby's mouth, the wailing ceased. Aaron was relieved to see that Brooke was right about the reason why the baby was.
Okay, so here's another opportunity to do something, right? Oh, they're worried that they might not know what to do with the baby. They might do something wrong with the baby. So have them do something wrong with the baby. Nothing. Nothing. There are so many, all this shit is cliche, right? But cliche is something. Something happens, right? It's just nothing. It's just maybe something bad will happen. No. Aaron's alone. Maybe he'll have a breakdown. No. Oh, they have a wedding. Their wedding's nothing happens. They go. They do it. They no. It's like nothing. Nothing. Nothing ever fucking happens. Who cares? They have a baby. I don't fucking care. Have the baby die. I don't give a shit. At least I'd be invested. Hey, and transitioning from that, thank you, Mr. Furley. The worst part about this book is that he expected people to pay money for it. Yeah, isn't it like $25 on bambooks.com? I mean, I know, I doubt he sets the prices, but yeah, no, absolutely not. First of all, nobody's gonna, very few people are going to buy just a random book. But no one's gonna buy a book by a pedophile, and no one's gonna buy this hot fucking garbage.
Crying. He heard his mother's horn sound on her car as she pulled in the driveway.
Why
he
would you
opened the door
honk
and
your
shouted,
horn while there's
"Hi,
a
Grand
newborn baby inside?
Ma, do you need any help with anything?" Aaron asked his mother. "No, I don't, Daddy. I've got it all just fine,"
Oh,
she
Christ.
retorted as she closed her car door and began walking toward the house. Aaron waited for his mother with the door open and then closed it behind her when she was inside. Sadie, stop it. "Hi, Brooke. I see it didn't take long for the baby to get hungry, huh?" Aaron's mother smiled at the sight of her daughter-in-law in her new.
If I were Brooke, I'd be like, "Hey, yeah, hey, thanks for coming. Aaron, can I talk to you? Can you fucking get your mom out of here, or I'm gonna lose my shit because she's always fucking here, and I had to spend the last couple of nights talking to her while you slept in the waiting room, you fucking asshole. So get your mom the fuck out of here, all right?" I'd be so pissed off. Be like, "Dude, okay, you need to get your mom the fuck out of here. We're moving. We're moving. Your job, what's your job? I don't know what your job is, Aaron, but we're moving somewhere else. I'm sick of your goddamn mom being here every 15 minutes. Get her the fuck, get her out of our fucking lives. She's everywhere all the time. I'm surprised she even had to come over and that she wasn't just like taking a nap in their bed when they got home."
New grandson on the couch. It made her happy to see her son's
Cat G, if anything, I need more
life
caffeine.
coming together so well. No, it didn't. He's taking it quite fast, too, Brooke replied. You might want to try to burp him after he drinks a couple ounces. If you don't, he'll get a bellyache.
Who cares? Okay, baby shit.
Brooke removed
we get
the bottle
it.
To
There's a
baby.
Baby
had drank already. It read 3 ounces. She
Who
set
cares?
The bottle down and moved the baby's head up to her shoulder and began rubbing
I have so
the baby's
many,
back.
I have so many notes on this book, and they're all who cares.
An upward motion to help push out the air in his belly.
Okay, I know what burping is.
He began wailing until all of a sudden a small belch came. The baby stopped crying after he belched, so Brooke cradled and rocked him until he fell asleep. Aaron.
Okay.
You should take the baby from Brooke and set him in his crib.
Yeah, cornhole three-way. He works fixing, what are they called? School buses, right? A pedophile wrote a book about a character who has a kid and gets married to a teenager and works on school buses. Ooh, I don't know about that. Hey, thanks, David Kendrick. Lauren is so ignorant of baby care that he does not realize basic things like you do not leave a baby bottle sitting on the counter to spoil. Yeah, it's weird that he would include this shit. Like, no one is looking for a step-by-step analysis of baby care, but Lauren is the last person in the goddamn world to be delivering it. Like, here's what happens.
Brooke's falling asleep, and I'm sure a nap would do her some good, his mother said.
Octopushy, the baby is black. Aaron's just choosing not to acknowledge that fact. He's in denial. That Brooke clearly cheated on.
He did as his mother recommended. And turned the
baby's Asian and black, which is weird because neither Brooke nor Aaron are either of those things. Like, it's neither of their kid somehow. You know? Hey, thanks, Joey. Stop trying to find fault. It's supposed to be false, Joey. Stop trying to find false with my book, Che May. He actually does a Q&A at the end of this, which we'll listen to when we get done, and I'm very much looking forward to it. At the end of the book, I mean.
And set it in the crib near the baby, so they would be able to hear him better. After the monitor was in place, he returned to the living room to help Brooke from the couch to the bedroom. Once he helped her get comfortable in the bed,
she's not pregnant.
He kissed her and told her he loved her. Then went back to the kitchen to have a cup of coffee and a chat with his mom.
It's nighttime. Don't have coffee at nighttime. You're about to go to bed. Is he going to stay up all night watching Trevor? His mom's there. I thought that was his mom's job. Isn't she going to stay up all night and sew another whatever for Trevor?
Around 5 p.m., Aaron and his mother began making dinner. Brooke and the baby had been sleeping for 1.5 hours, and they figured they'd better get the dinner made in case the baby woke up.
The baby can't have the dinner. The baby needs baby food.
Aaron pulled some spaghetti out of the cupboard.
Or milk. I don't know. Do newborns eat spaghetti? I'm not so sure.
In the boiling water. Then over the baby monitor, he heard the baby begin to wail.
Again. Yeah, polynomial purpura.
Stay right there and tend to the food. I'll go check on him, his mother ordered with a slight smile. Aaron turned and grinned after seeing the anxious look.
Polynomial purpura. The doctor is black and the male nurse was Asian. So... I don't even know what to make of this.
When she quickly left the room to check on the baby. He knew his mother had picked the baby up. When the wailing stopped and the baby monitor turned silent. A few minutes later, his mother returned to the kitchen still wearing a smile.
All right, they
did. He's so adorable. Nothing like you was, she teased.
Oh,
gee, thanks, Mom, he replied. Aaron continued to serve...
That exchange was rewritten by Quentin Tarantino. Lauren called in a favor from an old friend. That's why it was so clever.
Set out 3 plates and 3 large drinking glasses on the table with utensils, butter, salt, and pepper. Mm-hmm. When the spaghetti was done, his mother pulled the colander out from the bottom cupboard and placed it in the sink to strain the water from the spaghetti. Why don't you go
wake up? We're getting... Step-by-step instructions for making spaghetti. We don't know what Aaron looks like. We don't know what his mom looks like. We don't know his mom's name. We don't know what the hospital looked like. We don't know what the wedding venue looked like. We don't know what happened while she was pregnant with the baby for 8 months. We don't know what the birthing was like other than her water broke. Oh, shit. And he turned the stove into the off position. We don't know any of that, but we do know how to make spaghetti.
talk, and I'll finish getting spaghetti, the spaghetti sauce and bread on the table.
Okay.
Said as she continued to work. Setting the large stir spoon down on the napkin on the counter, he made his way to the bedroom where Brooke was sound asleep. He shook her gently to wake her. Slowly, she looked up at him.
Brooke, our baby's dying! Brooke, get up! All right, glad you're up. We're going to have spaghetti now. No, the baby's fine. Don't worry about it.
And rubbing her eyes. Hi, honey, she greeted him. Is the baby all right? She asked. Yes, he's fine. I just came in to wake you up for dinner, he replied. What time is it? She asked.
Zaki, Quentin Tarantino also did some rewrites on Lauren's poem to Ramona. A vegan breakfast will await. I'll kiss your feet.
6:30
p.m. I don't remember how that poem went, but it was something like that.
Okay, let me go to the bathroom and wash up, then I'll be out. Brooke said as she began to remove her tired body from the bed. Okay, we'll be waiting for you, Aaron said in return. Aaron returned to the kitchen and grabbed some milk from the refrigerator, then filled all three glasses. Is Brooke awake? His mother asked. Yes.
Jim Rausch's mustache, yeah, no joke. Spaghetti making lasted longer than the wedding. Spaghetti making is equivalent to the wedding, the entirety of the lead up to the wedding itself, and then Brooke's pregnancy. Like, it's been going on for about a page, I would guesstimate here. And that's about as long as it took for all of that stuff that I just mentioned to happen. He really likes to pad this shit out with stuff that he knows, which is the most boring shit in the universe.
She's washing up, and then she'll be out, he answered.
Okay.
Brooke entered the room just as Aaron and his mother sat down at the table.
Maybe something's missing. Oh, we need garlic. Aaron, can you run to the store real quick and get some garlic? And Aaron runs to the store, and he has an episode, and he follows someone. And this is the part where he tracks somebody down, and they go into a ditch, and he kills his first person. He freaks out. Maybe he goes to the store, and then he blacks out. And so it's kind of like a mystery. What happened during those blackout times? And we don't know. And then the chapter ends with the news saying someone was murdered at the store. And his mom's like, oh my god, you were just at that store. I'm so glad it wasn't you. Something fucking happened. Get rid of this whole goddamn chapter.
The food smells good, she complimented.
Aaron's a regular.
Nothing special,
man,
just
yeah.
A quick meal, Aaron's mother replied. It still smells good to me, Brooke returned. Especially after having hospital food. Yeah, I can see why this smells so good.
Oh, man, that hospital food's awful.
So you have, after having hospital food for 2 days. Aaron's mother responded. Brooke no sooner finished eating her plate full of spaghetti when she heard a loud cry come from over the baby monitor. Honey, can you go get him and bring him to me, please? Brooke asked Aaron. Aaron knew she was still sore from having the baby and was trying not to move around much. So he did as she asked.
So if she wasn't still sore from having the baby, he would have been like, fuck off, bitch, you go get that kid. But since technically, yes, she did just have the baby, he'll help her out. He'll help his wife out because she's still recovering from childbirth. Why include that? That makes him sound like such a fucking asshole. Because she was still recovering from having the baby, Aaron thought, oh, Jesus, all right, I'll take care of my fucking kid for once. But don't ask me to do this again, Brooke. What an asshole. Fuck you, Aaron.
When he returned, she made her way to the sofa and was waiting to take the baby from him. Once he laid the baby in his arms, he fetched her a fresh bottle of milk and a hand.
No, Zaki. No, I don't want that. I just want something. I don't care. I don't care if there's no action. I don't care if there's no plot progression, character development, intelligent dialogue. I don't care if there's none of that. Just have something happen. Making spaghetti, really? Really? I mean, like, you know I shit on this guy a lot. That's kind of the point of, like, these videos. It's fun to do. But really? 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 He made spaghetti? That is included in your book? They fill out paperwork. I'm not making that up. You guys were here. You heard it. There was literally, most of this chapter has been filling out paperwork. That's the plurality of this chapter so far, is he's been filling out paperwork and making spaghetti. Like, honest, that's what's happening. He's making spaghetti and filling out paperwork. And also, a kid was born and they got married, but that's not really so important.
Oh, well. Way over her shoulder for when she birthed the baby.
The shoulders.
Brooke fed and burped the baby while Aaron and his mother cleaned the table and did the dishes.
Okay.
Once the dishes were finished.
Come on.
They retreated to the living room to watch TV for the rest of the night. Until bedtime.
And then something happened, or no?
He is so adorable. Nothing like you was, she teased. Gee, thanks, Mom. He replied.
Nothing like you was.
What?
This poor baby is fucked from the start. This entire family is full of fucking idiots.
Oh, wait a minute. Oh. I already read that part.
Yep. Find your spot, you got it.
Yeah. How's your drink taste, honey? I heard you swallow.
I guess Jamie's drinking an onion smoothie or something. Lauren's still finding a spot. Okay. And by the way, I sped this up 1.25 times, so...
Morning came early for Aaron's mother because she placed the baby monitor on the coffee. Because she placed the baby monitor on the coffee table by the couch where she slept.
Gotcha.
The baby only woke up twice during the night. Once at 1 a.m. and again at 4 a.m.
Okay. And what does that have to do with the story? Like, how does that change things? Why am I told that information? Just no reason? Okay.
Go back to sleep until 5:30 a.m. So Aaron's mother figured she may as well make some coffee and considered herself awake for the day.
This kind of, you know what this book kind of reminds me of? It kind of reminds me of Kennedy. Like, I'm having, like, the same, like, jitters, the same kind of, like, you know, I'm literally, like, normally I'm looking at, like, my computer screen or my video games or whatever I'm doing, right? And here, I'm, like, looking everywhere else in the room. I'm just kind of, I'm treating my computer like it's Lorne telling me this story. And, like, you know, I'm giving all of the nonverbal cues just subconsciously. That's my reaction to hearing this. Is to give nonverbal cues that I'm not listening anymore. Like, you know what I mean? That's how I feel listening to Kennedy shit. And that's how I feel listening to this story. Like, all right, gotcha. Like, I don't even care to hear the end of it anymore. Like, just wrap it up. Just tell me the end now, Lauren.
Fresh coffee brewing woke both Brooke and Aaron up from their much-needed sleep.
Gotcha.
They both threw their robes on and stumbled into the kitchen where they shared a look like they had just swallowed heaven when they tasted the coffee.
All right, third or fourth breakfast of the chapter.
You do look like you're in love with...
Yeah, if I ever do this again, if I ever listen to this book again, I'm gonna count the amount of times that they have breakfast. Because honestly, it's gotta... By the end of the book, we're about halfway through the book. By the end of the book, it's gotta be... I wonder if it gets to 100. I honestly do. Because it's fucking ridiculous.
The coffee cups, Aaron's mother said as she laughed. That's because we are, Aaron replied. The next couple of days...
Why? Aaron slept fine. What's his deal? Why is he so in love with his coffee cup? He's been sleeping like a fucking... He's been sleeping the entire goddamn time. Why is he catching up on his much-needed sleep and needs coffee? He's been sleeping for most of the book.
Went by an Aaron and Brooke.
That's like indicative of Lorne, right? If anyone else is going through anything, if anyone else is going through a tough time, Lorne's going through an even tougher time. He's such a slut for sympathy. He's got to monopolize any bad thing that's going on. It's actually worse for me. No. Brooke, yeah, she just fucking had a baby. Yeah, I bet she's really tired and the coffee is really helping her wake up. Aaron, fuck you, bitch. Aaron got to sleep all night last night because his mom took care of the baby. The mom should be the one who's like, oh man, yeah, this coffee tastes like heaven. Aaron's such a fucking bitch. Be a man, you asshole. Don't make your mom stay up all night to take care of your baby, you fucking pussy. Stay up. Stay up all night. Man, drink coffee all night. You love drinking coffee. You can do that all night. It's going to keep you up. Watch your kid. Maybe he sees something on the news about Iraq and something happened. Maybe something happens. Dare that possibly happen in this chapter.
Couldn't have been more thankful to Aaron's mother for staying with them and helping them with the baby while Brooke was healing and they were both getting used to the baby's presence.
Mm.
They both felt sadness grow inside them when they watched Aaron's mother drive away. Over the next couple of months, they had family and friends coming in and out to see and welcome the new member to the family. Aaron had never taken so many pictures in his life as he did the first 6 months of little Trevor's life.
Oh, 6 months. He
couldn't believe how much his son had grown in such a short amount of time.
Okay.
Aaron worked as many hours as he could at the garage so that Brooke could stay home with the baby.
Garage.
He usually got in about 55-hour work week.
Who cares? Who cares? Why does that... Oh, my God. Why? Is that distracting him from his PTSD? He's so busy at work that he doesn't have time to murder people? Is that going to... And then maybe he gets laid off, or maybe later because he gets an injury, right? He cuts his hands. Then maybe he can't work for a couple of weeks and, you know, idle hands are the devil's playthings, and he starts murdering because he's not busy at work. No, it's just he works 55 hours a week. Who cares? No one cares. Oh, Trevor is growing so much. He's such a fat fucking child after 6 months. 6 months passed. Another 6 months. 8 months passed and Brooke was pregnant. A certain amount of time passed and they were having the wedding. Now 6 more months have passed. We're like jumping 7 fucking years in this chapter. And thankfully, a lot's happened, right? I mean, we don't know what's happened except for that he made spaghetti and filled out paperwork. But, you know, it's been a busy couple of years for your boy Aaron. Apparently he's got a job at a garage. I don't know what the fuck that means. Explain his job. Explain his application process. I don't know. I don't know. Just
they were, so they were able to live good and still be able to save a small amount of money from every paycheck because he made
that's
a better
true, Catchy.
Than average hourly wage.
I made a better than average hourly wage. I don't know what that means. He makes good money, but they needed to make a bunch of money for when the baby came, so they didn't go on a honeymoon, but Aaron makes better than average hourly wage, and he works 55 hours a week. So they must be swimming in it. They must have plenty of money. Plus, they own their home, or they live in a home, because they have a house. So they've got a house. So I are they broke or not?
Soon after Trevor Michael had turned a year old, Aaron began having some of his nightmares again. He'd wake up in a cold sweat and have to carefully get out of bed so he wouldn't wake Brooke. He normally went into the bathroom and splashed his face clean, take a few deep breaths, then go back to bed and be able to sleep fine the rest of the night. However, there was one night that...
Oh, okay. I guess this happens now. Yeah, I shouldn't bitch. Technically, something's happening. I don't know why or how or what story significance it has, but something is, something's happening.
The nightmare had been so bad that he woke himself up screaming. He sat straight up in bed and found Brooke was on the floor.
Scheme! Did he scream like he told Debbie to scream at the airport?
He scared the dickens out of her. And when she jumped away, she landed with a thud on the floor. Brooke reached up to turn the light on. Brooke reached up to turn the light onto the lamp that sat on her nightstand. She needed to see better than what the nightlight would allow. When the room brightened so she could see more, she found Aaron.
Yes, she turned on the lamp.
His eyes were soaked with tears. Brooke was stunned. She quickly climbed back into bed and placed her hand on his sweaty face. Are you all right? She asked worriedly.
Hey, asshole, you just knocked me out of bed. No, are you all right? Oh, Aaron, are you having another nightmare? He's been having nightmares for a long time. I guess he's been sneaking out of bed to not awaken her. This is like are these the dumbest people ever? Hey, you were at war and have PTSD and are experiencing side effects from it. Maybe you should talk to somebody.
Aaron was breathing heavily as he exhausted an answer back to her.
Okay.
Yeah, I just had a bad dream. I'm sorry I woke you, honey. It's all right. You want to talk about it? She asked in deep concern. No. I think I just need to get a drink to cool myself down and a quick shower and I'll be all right, he replied. Aaron got up and went to the kitchen for a tall glass of milk.
Yeah, right, yeah. A tall glass of milk and a quick shower cures PTSD.
He peeked in to check on Trevor Michael on his way to the bathroom.
Send word to the military.
Still asleep. Thank God I didn't wake him up, too. He said quietly to himself as he pulled the door closed behind him and then got into the shower. Once he was under the cool water, he began to feel his eyes tearing up again because of the nightmare he had. Why am I going through this? Why am I having these nightmares all over?
Three questions. Himself? One more.
After spending an hour under the cool water trying to regain himself,
okay,
Aaron dried himself off and returned to bed.
Okay, yeah, that solved it. Why am I having these nightmares? Why does this keep happening to me? And then he just goes back to bed. Okay, all right. That's how you guys solve problems, right? You know, something gets damaged. You know, somebody drives into your garage on accident. Why would somebody drive into my garage on accident? How is this going to get fixed? And then you just walk away. You don't call anyone. You don't call your insurance. And go, hey, yeah, someone crashed into my house. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. I'll just leave it there. Okay. Yeah, cool. That's kind of how Lauren handles things, so fair enough. It's worked out well for him so far.
Brooke had gone back to sleep, so he didn't bother cuddling up with her. Instead, he lay there with his eyes open and staring blindly into the darkness until daylight began showing through the window. He looked over at the alarm clock as it read 5:32 a.m.
Did he have breakfast?
He threw some jeans and a t-shirt on without waking Brooke. Come on, pretty girl. He threw some jeans and a t-shirt on without waking Brooke.
Okay.
He went to the kitchen and made himself some coffee.
Oh, really? 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 Did he have breakfast? Really? That's such a strange detour from the typical goings-on of this character. Wow, he's having breakfast now, guys. Did everybody get that? For the fourth time in the chapter, he's having breakfast. Yeah, Paula's laugh. This is still chapter 8. Remember how this started? They weren't even married yet, and now they're, like, deep into married life. And believe it or not, they're having breakfast again.
Trevor Michael began talking. Aaron went in to check on him.
What?
He found him
He's
standing at
now?
The edge of his crib, mumbling as he was rubbing his little finger back and forth along the top of the crib.
You were saying, I want coffee.
He looked up when he saw Aaron swing the door open and reach his little arms out straight for his dad to pick him up and take him out of the crib.
What if Trevor didn't recognize Aaron? He's so busy at work. And that pissed Aaron off. And then he leaves. We end the chapter with him leaving angry. Oh, no! What's going to happen next chapter? Nope.
Aaron walked toward his son and did as his son wished. After he had him in his arms, Aaron realized he should have changed Trevor's diapers before he picked him up. Because now he had baby poop and pee on his arm and his t-shirt.
Okay. What is
well,
he,
I guess you got the best of daddy this morning, didn't you? Aaron said to his son with a bland
How did he get
look on his
shit
face.
On his shirt?
Trevor looked at his dad and giggled as Aaron set him down on the changing table and began changing Trevor's diaper.
Mm-hmm.
Once he was finished with that smelly task, he put Trevor's socks on and coveralls and cleaned off his own arm. When he picked up Trevor and turned around, Brooke was standing there watching Aaron in admiration. Mom, Trevor muttered as he reached.
He finally changed his baby's diaper. I wonder if he's ever changed a diaper before. But clearly not. He's not very practiced at it. I get that you can get urine, right? Baby starts peeing while you're changing their diaper. How did he get shit on his shirt? How did that happen?
So, his hands for his mother to take him. Brooke took Trevor from Aaron and leaned her head.
Oh, of course. Yeah, that's enough. That's enough parenting for you for one day, Aaron. Now go watch TV and take a nap on the couch and catch up on your much-needed rest.
Toward Aaron, give him a kiss. Aaron adored the sight in front of him.
Here, have some more coffee and a Danish.
And Brooke could see it all over his face.
Is your mom coming over later?
They both turned and walked to the table, and Aaron pulled the high chair in for Brooke to place Trevor in it. They let Trevor feed himself the scrambled eggs they gave him, and they ate French toast. There was quite a mess to clean up.
Yeah. Thanks, David Kendrick. Yeah, I'm worried for Eelrig's health at this point. I can't picture a sane man getting this pissed at a pedophile's idea of breakfast. I know. Yeah, I'm unhinged. This is what pedophile poetry does to me. I'm more upset at how poorly this is written than like the offensive nature of this book. To be honest with you. Like, it's really awful that he'd write a book about PTSD and murder and shit, but I'm more angry at the structure. You know, go back in, Lauren. Create an outline. Come on now.
It was quite a mess to clean off the high chair when Trevor was finished, but he seemed to enjoy what he ate of his breakfast.
Okay.
After Brooke got Trevor cleaned up and Aaron got the mess cleaned from the high chair and the table, they put Trevor in the playpen. and left him to play while they sat with their coffee cups at the table.
More coffee.
I want to talk about the nightmare you had last night, Buck blurted out. Aaron looked up at her in surprise. He didn't think that she would bring it up. Or at least he was hoping she wouldn't.
You knocked her out of bed last night. Why wouldn't she bring it up?
I'd really rather not talk about it, honey, he replied. I do, she demanded. What happened last night scared me. I think it's important to talk about it. I'm sorry I scared you. I don't know why my nightmare was as bad as it was, but it scared me too, he exclaimed.
And this is Lauren in a nutshell, you know. Somebody says, you have a serious problem. We need to talk about it. And he goes, oh, we're hoping we didn't have to talk about it, but I'm sorry about what I did. And this should be the end of it. It's weird. I don't know if he's intentionally trying to paint Aaron in a bad light here by not wanting to talk about it. I don't think that's intentional. I think it's not Aaron's fault. None of this is Aaron's fault. He shouldn't have been at war. It's not his fault. He's a good guy.
Will you please go see a psychiatrist? For me and Trevor, at least. There's obviously some things that are still bothering you from the war. She said with a look of worry and emotion. Aaron let out a deep sigh. I'm going to go for a walk. I'll be back in a little while. Aaron kissed her on the lips and gave her a squeeze on her shoulder, then turned and walked out the door.
Okay. That's the whole conversation. You had a nightmare. Is this an ongoing thing? Was last night the first time that I was awoken by it? Do you have problems? You should talk to somebody. A lot of things to bring up, but instead she's like, you should go and see a psychiatrist. And he's like, oh, okay, I guess I'll do it. I'm going to leave for the rest of the day now. What? I fucking hate... The chapter's almost over. I'll save it for...
Brooke walked to the window and watched him as he walked down the driveway.
Okay, that's how chapter 8 ends, by the way. But I fucking hate how frequently Aaron just leaves. He's like, I'm going to leave for a day. And Brooke's like, okay, well, I'll see you when you get back. No! We have a fucking child together. You're not just going to leave. You're not just going to leave for days at a time. And Lauren would love that. He would love to leave and go and visit the child that he was talking to online and have no one question him. But that's not how it works. No one's going to accept that, you fucking idiot. All right. Normally at the end of these, I do like a fix. I mean, honestly, this should be three chapters. So the wedding is one chapter. Something happens that makes Brooke kind of cautious. And things don't go so well at the end of that. Number two, the baby chapter. The baby's born. Aaron blacks out. He goes to the store and blacks out and can't remember what happened at the store. We're going to find out later that he killed someone. The next chapter, he starts having nightmares again. He gets a job. He's busy at his job. He should get injured in that chapter, combined chapter 9 and 10, where he cuts his finger and has to go to the hospital. He gets injured and he's not working as much and he has some free time and he starts murdering people and he finds out he's been murdering people for a long time. And that's where we leave chapter whatever. That is what chapter 8 should have been. Okay. Robsop is streaming right now. So click on this link. Go and listen to some Robsop. And yeah. This chapter really fucking pissed me off. All right, I will see you guys at some point in the future. Oh, hello, The Fifth Ace. Angry book review. Yeah, I know. I'm a hateful person. Especially when it comes to pedophiles. All right, I will see you guys next time.
When my back is to the world, that was smiling when I turn. Tell you you're the greatest, but once you turn, they hate us. Oh, the misery, everybody wants to be my enemy. Spare the sympathy, everybody wants to be my enemy. On the wall as you're praying for my phone and the laughter in the halls and the names that I've been called. I stack it in my mind and I'm waiting for the time.
time when I show you what it's like to be worse fit in a mind.
Okay, I'm hoping that somebody pray for me. I'm praying that somebody hope for me. I'm staying where nobody supposed to be. Papa posted, being a wreck of emotions. Ready to go whenever you let me know. The road is long, so put the pedal into the flow. The energy on my trail, my energy unavailable. I'ma tell it my silhouette go. Hey, when I fly on my drive to the top, I've been out of shape, taking out the box, I'm an astronaut. I blasted off the planet, rock to cause catastrophe, and it matters more because I had it. Now I had, I thought about wreaking havoc on an opposition. Kinda shocking, they want a static with precision. I'm automatic, quarterback, I ain't talking sack and pack it up, I don't panic. Batter up, who the baddest, it don't matter, cause we is your
everybody wants to be my enemy.